In fact, I would put a priority on it even above Sylvia's article. No. Just because, from this standpoint, I think it's very important to actually read some of Kepler, just to, as to read Coues, you know, as to read Leonardo, even from the notebooks. Oh, the Cosmographic of Mysterium. So I would suggest the first 12 chapters, the rest of the book is useful too, but in terms of the 12 chapters that I copied for Craig, I just would urge people to get it from Craig, make a copy, and take a look at it. Take a look at a couple of the chapters, just begin to get a sense of it. I just think it's very important. Because until people actually begin reading and working through this material themselves, we're just repeating the same mistake that's been made before. We're just we're basically reading a textbook to get what others have done, rather than to actually replicate the experiment in a certain sense ourselves and work our way through the problems ourselves. So at this point, we'll be on Kepler for at least, well, probably two more weeks. Certainly one, well, yeah, two to three more weeks at the rate we're going. And of course, we're covering the whole universe, so maybe, you know, we could be on this forever. But that's what I would emphasize now. And then in 2 weeks, I'll make copies of, for people who don't already have it, of the snowflake paper by Kepler. So last week we discussed Kepler's derivation of the orbits prior to the existence of the planets, in a certain sense. The derivation of the orbits of planets from the Platonic solids, from an organization of the Platonic solids, the five solids that we're familiar with. What I want to do to start out this week is to consider how, how Kepler was actually able to compare the solids to the orbits of the planets. The question came up last week, well, how did they know what the orbits of the planets were? I mean, Pluto is a long ways away. Well, forget about Pluto, but Jupiter, Mars, the asteroid belt. How did they even measure these bodies in that day and age, right, in the beginnings of the 17th century? Also, the question should have come to your mind, and maybe one of these things you worked out, but it's probably not one of the things that you worked out, was actually how you determine what the circumference of the circles, the relative circumferences of the circles of the different solids are. Which you have to have if you're going to compare the orbits of the planets, which you have to have, to the solids, the circumference of which you have to have, right, inner and outer. The inner circumference within each of the solids and the outer circumference, inscribed and circumscribed spheres, okay? So we're going to do that. Now, just first of all, this is kind of to just get people kind of thinking in the geometrically here. In the literal sense. People familiar with astronomical units, what astronomical units are? How many people knew, if they were asked back in college, or high school, as the case may be, what the asteroids were? How many people knew what they were? Half the room? I didn't. I mean, I'm just being frank. I mean, the asteroids were just some bodies up in space that maybe would run into spaceships. I mean, I didn't know that there was an actual asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. So, well, maybe two-thirds of you knew. I didn't. But that was just I was just curious. I just was curious just to know. astronomical units, somewhat similar. It's not a big, hairy concept. Astronomical units is to take the distance between the Earth and the Sun as your primary metric, and call that one. All right, astronomical unit. All right, so this you're using as your measure the distance between the Earth and Sun, and then comparing all the other planets. Right, thusly. Yeah, at the average distance, right. The average distance of the Earth's orbit from the Sun. And similarly, each of the other planets and comparing them, which is what I've done here, okay? This is just, maybe I can put it back here so everyone can see it, okay? Here's, in terms of astronomical units, Mercury is 0.387, Venus is 0.723, Earth 1, Mars 1.5, Jupiter 5.203, so Jupiter is 5 times further from the Sun than the Earth, right? Okay. Saturn 9.539, Uranus 19.18, Neptune 30.06, Pluto 39.44. Now, I've already drawn these figures up here alongside, so you may have already made the comparison, but if you think about it, if you just look at these relationships, things start jumping out at you in terms of the relationships among the planets. Huh?
Is the right-hand column derived from Kepler?
No, it's just, I just did it. It's just simple. It's just simple. This 387 rounded up to 4.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
4, you know, 4 is 1/10 of, I'm going to go through it. I'm not just answering your question. 4, right, is to 10 is 2/5, right? 723, right, as a fraction, right, of 1, 0.723 is 2/3, roughly, give or take, right? One. Now look at what happens. If you're not just a raving empiricist and just saying, well, if you're actually interested in looking at something in a beautiful way and looking for harmonic relationships that will give you some insight into things, well, look, here you go, Earth to Mars, 1.5. Up here to Jupiter is 5, rounded off. Saturn is 10. Uranus is 20. Neptune, 30. Pluto, 40. Huh? 1.5, 5, 10, 20, 30, 40. I mean, that's without looking at the platonic solids, right? That's simply looking at the distances. Just a very simple thing. So what I'm saying is this idea of a relationship among the planets' orbits, once you know a few things about the planets in terms of their distances, you know, begins to jump out at you. It's not a thing that you have to work at to find, okay? In terms of just what some of the things could have been inspiring Kepler in this regard, huh? Or anyone else, or it should inspire us. Now, to continue to look comparing. We'll come back to this question of astronomical units in a second. Excuse me for a second. But if we, because astronomical units is related also to this question of determining these distances, which we'll come back to in a second, distance of the Earth to the Sun, which we'll need. Well, maybe we should just do that next. Consider the distance from the Earth to the Sun. How do we know the distances of various planets? From the Sun. How would Kepler know that? How would Copernicus know that? That came up. Debbie asked that last week, right? And we said we would answer it this week. Huh?
From the angle of the sky?
No, I think you're thinking more of, that's how you, certainly you can find out your latitude, right? as people know, if you go outside and you right now, living at the time we do, if you take the North Pole as your point that you're looking at, since that's essentially directly over the North Pole, and you take and you look up and you take the angle between your horizon and the North Pole, that angle, that number of degrees, is your degrees latitude. Okay? So that's latitude is a very easy thing. It's always been easy for navigators and so on to work out. Longitude, going around the Earth, that's another question, right? That gets a little more complicated. So in terms of determining latitude, you could do that. And in terms of taking the bearings of stars over time to see how they change, right, or to see how you move relative to the stars, right? If you're moving south, certain star will, you know, will have appeared at a certain number of degrees above the horizon. You know, if you move south, you know, you can gather something from that in terms of information about how far south you've moved. Any other thoughts? Dan brought up triangulation, I think. You mentioned that last week, did you? Or maybe you were thinking of something else. But here, let me give you, this is how Copernicus did it. Now, where he got it from, it's not exactly clear. There's I believe, a derivation of this from Ptolemy and from Ptolemy's deference and epicycles. But it's pretty simple. Does that show up? We'll look here at the, we'll take this as the sun. And we'll take this as the Earth. And we'll take this as the planet we want to know. Yeah, let's see. Just gonna. Well, we know the distance from the Earth to the sun. It's one. One astronomical unit, all right? So we wait until the planet is at right angles to the sun, the planet we're trying to look at, and we know the distance to this side, and we can measure that amount of degrees, right? So then we can determine the distance from here to that planet. We can also determine the distance from the sun to that planet.
How do we know when it's alert?
Well, that's,
you know,
that's
the point of the Earth and the Sun.
Yeah.
Right.
You can plot where the other planet is in relation to the zodiac.
You'd have to watch it going around and around and around.
Yeah, sure.
You're also talking about taking the Sun, which you see during the day, versus the stars and planets, which you see at night. So you're talking about it taking a mean orbit of the Sun, you know, and establishing what that is, right? And then, you know, triangulating with a right triangle your distances. And then based on an astronomical unit is the distance from the sun to the Earth, you can determine the relatively, right, by the Pythagorean theorem, or through trigonometry, you can determine the distance of the planets, the various other planets from the sun, those that you can see. Now, Pluto, you have to wait a long time, maybe, right? But it also turns out, now this is something I haven't worked through. I was just going over this with David Cherry. This question actually sent off a whole series of communications around, because nobody knew the answer to this, because nobody had bothered to think about it exactly. So Ken Cronberg, David Cherry, I was talking to various people, and everyone came up with the answer, but just, I don't want to take it beyond the scope of what I know, but it's, it turns out, by one of these marvelous inventions of God, that in measuring the planets, and this partly is the answer to your question, when that planet is the furthest from the sun, happens to be where the angle, this angle, is greatest. So if you know the sun and you're waiting for this angle to increase, or as the case may be here, and it works out that way. And we'll try to come back to that. I don't know exactly why that is. It may be obvious to somebody else. But that apparently is the case. So anyway, that's a rough answer to your question. It doesn't give you the actual measurement of the distances from the planets, but it gives them relative to Earth, right? Proportionally. And so if you have the proportions, then you can work the proportions in terms of the solids comparatively with the solids, right? Because you're talking about proportions of the solids. Okay? Okay, did people hear what Dan said? I don't know this or not.
If I remember right, the distance to the Earth, between the Earth and the Sun, wasn't accurately measured until something like the 18th century. But AUs was just an approximation. They didn't know what the distance in miles was. So they just said, well, distance is one AU and everything's a multiple or a fraction of that.
Mm-hmm.
But if we figure out what it is in the future, then we'll know what everything else will fall into place.
Okay.
Yep. I think that with the angle being maximum when it's at a right angle is true when you're looking at an inner planet. See, if you have the long distance there,
mm-hmm.
and the short distance the planet you're looking at,
mm-hmm.
and then you see the little planet making an inner circle there,
mm-hmm.
then it makes sense that the angle would be a maximum.
Mm-hmm.
If you think about the little planet going around the sun,
mm-hmm.
and what kind of a triangle.
Okay, I'm just saying, this is something that was told to me, and it was said as a general statement, not as applying to certain planets, and I don't want to try to solve the question right now. You may be right. It may have only a limited application. But it's as far as I can get at this point to answer Debbie's question, but also to, I think it's useful from the standpoint of what we're trying to do with the class to bring it in now. In terms of Kepler's working on the working with the solids, I just wanted to go through briefly here. Mike, could you give me a couple of these blanks? It's actually somewhat easier just to write on these things. Or Ahmad or Craig, there's a package of these blank transparencies sitting out there on the table by the copying machine. Oh, is there transparency pins?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, anyway, let me go through this very briefly. If you take, for example, the dodecahedron, and you want to, the inscribed and circumscribed spheres are, in fact, very determined. There's, you'd have to work these through yourself, which I would challenge you to do. But for the sake of things here, let's just look at them and compare them to the orbits of the planets. Let's see here. So for the dodecahedron, these will sound pretty weird, some of these relationships, but they're also kind of fun to at least hear about. The distance from the center of the polyhedra, this in this case the dodecahedron, and to the center of the face, right? Which, if you're talking about the dodecahedra, right, that's the center of the faces as the inscribed sphere, right? That distance is pi, or let's see, no, it's a, I'm sorry, it's the golden mean. What is it? Is that the golden mean, like that?
Yeah.
Yep. Hmm? Times 2 times 5 to the 1/4 power, which is equal to 1.135. That's what you want to know, all right? If you take the distance of the vertices, to the vertices, right, which is
that's supposed to be pi, the last number? So golden mean. No, the other end.
You're just, the side is 1. I think the side is 1. If you then take the, so that's to the inside of the faces, right, to the center of the faces. Right? All right. So then if you take to the vertices for the dodecahedron, the relationship is the following. This is the golden mean. Okay. So that's for the vertices. These are both for the dodecahedron. Okay. All right. So now Kepler places the dodecahedron between Earth and Mars. All right. Earth's orbit, we know, is 149.6 million kilometers, approximately, average orbit. Mars, just throwing these numbers around, you know, a million here, a million there. Mars, that's right, big money here. Mars and Earth, okay? So let's compare these ratios. 1.13 5 to 1.4 0 3, right? Because these are the two, right? Earth is Brian, I just lost you. You flipped the switch on. Testing 1 2, testing. Anyway, if we compare these So we get here, we get 6 5 6 4 3. Here we get 7 9 4 6 2. Right? Comparison of the distances of the planets themselves, and this is the relationship, proportional relationship between, or mean relationship, arithmetically between the inner and outer of the dodecahedron, inscribed and circumscribed spheres. I'm just shorting it. I'm not giving you the, well, I can give you the quote-unquote formula if you want. And then if we compare the distances of planets, 108.2 and Earth 149.6, well, we get point, make sure I don't run out of space here, 72326. And over here we get 0.79466. So that's for the icosahedron compared to the relationship between Earth and Venus, huh? Okay. Let's take Jupiter and Saturn just to see. I mean, until you look at these things, you don't know, right? So if you take, this is very straightforward. Okay, you place the cube between Jupiter and Saturn in Kepler's arrangement. So we have a cube, or let's see, here's the cube. Ah, okay. So we're talking about comparing. This is what you wanted me to do, right? Okay. We're talking about, if you take the circumscribed sphere around the cube, right? What's that sphere, if you will, where's it going to touch the cube?
On the corners.
On the corners, right? That's called the vertices. Okay? So the distance from the center of the cube out to the vertice is going to be the radius of the circumscribing sphere. At the same time, will be the same as the distance from the center of the cube to the vertice, because that's where they touch, right? Okay, so that's the outer circle. That's the circumscribed sphere, right? The inscribed sphere, inscribed, excuse my Midwest accent, will rest where? If you just think about, right. Do you see that, Betty? Can you see that in your mind's eye, that the inside sphere would rest on the inside of each of these the faces? Uh-huh. Okay. So the distance from the center out to the center of the face would give the radius of the inscribed sphere. Comprendo? Okay. So that's what we're doing. So we're comparing these relationships between the center to the center of the face and to the vertice, right? And comparing that now to Jupiter versus Saturn, because Kepler has placed those as the inscribed and circumscribed orbits with the cube separating them.
Before you hit that, since I got lost in the I know what you just said, but I got lost when you put up the golden mean, and I didn't know where you came up with those numbers at the very beginning.
Right.
We'll
have to come back to that another week. That's a whole another project. I mean,
you just started putting up these numbers saying this is what it is, and
it's a formula.
Yeah.
You didn't derive it, it's a formula.
I didn't derive it here. For the moment, as I said a minute ago, you should work these things out yourself. I'm not going to do everything for you. You got to do a certain number of things yourself on this stuff.
Huh?
Is it Kepler's formula?
He's solid, he has all these various things.
These formulae in the solids have been known since the Greeks. These are not new formulae. These are old formulae. Because all these relationships have been studied. For example, just think about it in terms of the cube, which makes it very simple. If you notice, in both the icosahedron and the dodecahedron, you're dealing with formulas that involved the golden mean. Okay, in the formulas. Okay, I'll just give it here. What is it for the cube? For the center of the face to the center of the polyhedra, right? The inner measurement we want. What is it? Okay, for the cube center to its face, that's the formula. For the vertex, the square root of 3/2, right? In other words, they're Pythagorean, right? Remember Kepler said there's two golden treasures? There's two golden treasures, the Pythagorean theorem and the golden mean. Those are the two golden treasures. Well, we found, just thinking about the icosahedron and dodecahedron, their formulas for deriving the radiuses, right, of their inscribed and to the vertice and the center of the faces involved in golden mean. But in the case of the cube, and it's the same for the octahedra and so forth, the pyramid, you're dealing with Pythagorean relationships, quote unquote, very simple relationships.
So that would be the same formula.
Boringly simple. Huh? Similar. Just think about it. Just think about the distances and what you would have to do to figure it out. When you start with the cube and the pyramid and the octahedra, it's pretty easy to figure out what you would do to figure out the distances, to come up with the formula yourself. So I'm just suggesting that people do that. It's not very complicated. So if we take Jupiter and Saturn using the cube, first of all, if we compare their let's see if I finish this up. The distances are 778.3. Of course, we're talking about millions of kilometers versus 1,427 kilometers. Okay, Jupiter to Saturn. All right, that comes out to 0.54541, if you want to get particular. Okay, relationship of Jupiter to Saturn, right? That's in millions of kilometers, right? Okay. Well, yeah. Yeah, I already said that. Yeah, they're mean distances. 1/2 over the square root of 3/2. Okay, what does that work out to? Well, cancel out the 2s, right? Above and below, you get 1/3. And so what do you get? Nobody's real fast on this stuff, huh? Okay, 5.57735 compared to 0.54541. Well, these are pretty incredible comparisons, right? When you're talking about over millions of kilometers of miles, right? Where you when you're comparing these, huh? But that's basically how it's done. Yeah, well, yeah, I worked it out, but it's not that complicated. So let's see. All right. Now, there's two directions in which we can go right now, and I think I'm going to choose the second, which is I think I'm just going to go to the constructions. To the constructing you're going to do. So then you don't ask so many questions. Let me just put up here for now, over here on the, you see here, these are the comparisons that Kepler came up with, comparing the aphelion and perihelions of the different planets, and then defining their relationships. Here you see Saturn at the aphelion. Aphelion is the furthest away. Perihelion is the closest in to the sun. Right? In terms of minutes and seconds, right? In terms of arc. Okay. And for each of them in a given amount of time. And then comparing them, right, relatively, and getting a relation of 4/5. And that's a major third, C to E, and so on and so forth, and going through the different planets. But rather than go through how he did it, I think it's better that we just construct it ourselves, okay? And what we're going to do is we're not going to take Kepler, since we know there's 9 planets now. We're going to take Jonathan's derivation of the 9 planets and the harmonic relationships among the 9 planets as our basis, okay? So what I'd like people to do is actually kind of group, if you can, into groups of 3 or 4, and we'll actually do something like this, what I've done up here on a much smaller scale. We'll probably just get as far as the inner planets inside the asteroid belt. So all you need is a 8.5 by 11 paper, but you need a ruler. A ruler that has millimeters on one side, right? Inches on the other, but we need millimeters to compress down millions of kilometers into a small area, all right? And you need a compass. Probably you can do this with a compass, the inner planets. If you're going to do this, I mean, you'd have to have a pretty big compass to do this. That's where the string comes in. So if people can group themselves into 3, please spiral out. One rotation, right? One rotation on a cone. We haven't talked in these classes about... Oh, I got 2 there, don't I?
Yeah.
Well, how's that? Well, the problem is we can't, hard time erasing these things. Anyway, people have got the idea. One complete rotation up the cone, if you are familiar with spirals on cones, on a 1-2 cone, for example, we'll come back to that in terms of the harmonic mean. Hmm?
Oh, and Neptune's the...
Okay, so here's the sun, and we're going to say, of course, I mean, my drawing's horrible, but if we take, if we take that distance, and we'll take the surface of the sun, we'll normalize, the sun is 0.0046 AUs, astronomical units, okay? But we'll just talk about it. The sun is one. We're just going to normalize it to one. And we take it out to the distance to Neptune.
Normalize the sun to zero.
Zero.
No, because then we won't be able to do anything with it. You can't calculate. Zero times whatever is going to give us zero. So we're going to normalize it to one, okay? And we take Neptune, which is 4,497 million kilometers, or 30.7 astronomical units. The geometric mean, which is the square root of A plus B, okay? Is anybody fast at this kind of stuff? Okay. So if you take 1 times, you take the square, it's the square root of, well, what do I got here? It comes out to about 67. You're taking the square root of 4497, right? Because you're taking 1, which is the sun, A, it's not plus, it's A times B, square root of A times B. If you take 1 times 4,497, do I have a right figure? 4,005. I've got two sets of figures here, so we'll say 537. So that gives you 1 times 4,537, right? Well, obviously gives you 4,537, so that's A times B. Take the square root of it, right? And you get the geometric mean, which is about 69.7. Okay? Well, what's 69.7 between the sun and Neptune? What planet has 60, what's...
Mercury.
Look at that, Mercury, 69.7. We just took the geometric mean between the sun and Neptune at 4,537 million kilometers, found the geometric mean, and we hit Mercury on the dot. Hmm? That is God the geometer, huh?
Surface.
Yeah, yeah.
It's actually an expanded surface of the sun. You make the surface, you make the sun 1 as opposed to 0.0046. You make the sun.
Yeah, well, that's not the reason. You're just making it 1 to normalize it so you can do a math. You're taking 1 as your starting point from 1 to whatever number. Just think about it. It's not a matter of making the sun. It's just normalizing it. If you let's see. So, follow that? You got that?
Can you say once again what the geometric mean is on the spiral? What that refers to again?
It's
the arithmetic and the geometric, and I get them mixed up.
The arithmetic mean is the A plus B divided by 2, right?
Geometric
mean is the square root of A plus B, A times B. AB, square root of AB.
Yeah, what is half of this is up the cone, which is the arithmetic, and the geometric is half the rotation.
Yeah. The geometric mean is where the radius is one, is... say you're going from here to here, okay? You're talking about from here to here? You have one spiral, from here to here. It's the distance up the cone in which the radius from here to the geometric mean is doubled. And from there to there, it's doubled again. Okay? In other words, this is to this as this is to this. Okay? The radiuses. And that's the geometric mean. The geometric mean is that point on the spiral where the radiuses are in that relationship. Okay? And the harmonic mean is where the spiral, it's one half of the distance around, as opposed to one half the distance up.
It's the harmonic geometric mean that I always get mixed up, right? The harmonic mean is actually, what's that? That's Mars. That's what Mars turns out to be, right?
Oh, yeah, we're going to get
to that. Okay.
Yeah. You're going to have to work that out.
Uh-oh.
So let's see. So what Jonathan is saying is, okay, he says, now let's take, we've established one great circle of action. And we've generated, as the geometric mean, Mercury. Now we're going to create two spirals of action, two circles. Two complete rotations. One from the Sun to Mercury. And the second, which is what we're going to be concerned about, which is Mercury to Neptune. So we're going to take Mercury to Neptune, and we're going to find the geometric mean between those two planets. So why don't people do that? Square root of it, the square root of AB. Huh? Take the astronomical units. Here's the astronomical units. Where are they? Are they there?
Average distance from the sun?
Yeah, average distance of the sun, yeah.
The sun to...
That's in kilometers.
That's in kilometers?
Oh, that's
no, this is...
Oh, that, yeah, that's the...
Average distance from the sun. Okay?
The right-hand column is...
So if you wanted to, you could take this, 0.387, huh? Can't you? 0.387 times 30.06.
0.387 times what?
I don't know. You can see if that works out, if you can do that with astronomical units.
0.06? You multiply those, then what?
Then you find the square root.
I'm going to do it with paper.
Yeah, that's...
Where's the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter? Oh, so that's
huh?
I got 5:10.
Oh yeah.
It should be the asteroid belt, is it? The 45. With
his
calculator.
Shh. Well, I remember where we had. If you multiply 40, well, let's see. Yeah. It's the square root of 0.229446, right? In astronomical units. Who's doing it the long way? Okay, what did you get as by multiplying the two together? Oh, she's still doing it? Okay. Yeah.
What's the asteroid belt?
Yeah, but you don't have, yeah, but here you got McCallie helping you out.
No, that's my guess. Yes, he didn't say that. I said
what do you got for a number? McCallie, just
it's 562. So it's between Mars and Jupiter. It's 562. It's between
562. Well, here, come up and check. Then you can.
Oh.
This is the asteroid belt right there.
Right here.
Mm-hmm. From here to here. From here to here.
Okay.
So it's B.
It's 3 point something or other. It's 3 point something or other. Now what?
562.
Now what? Oh, it's Uranus.
562.
Right?
Upper UN.
Right?
Upper
UN. Outside the maximum of the asteroid. 3.04.
Okay. So you guys have got what number? You guys have got what? For your number, you.
562.
And you got what? Hey. 562.34.
Yeah.
All right.
233.
And you got 3.3 or something?
She came up with that multiplying
thing together. I don't know. We did a multiplication here. 11.6. Did they do that right?
11. And the square root.
Square root of that is something between 3 something, right?
She put the prime.
Square, so it's a 3 something or other. So it would be 3 times. Three times the Earth. Well, that's not so bad. See, then you got to take it times the distance of the Earth. So 3 times is 3 something or other, right?
Yeah.
Square root of 11 is 3.3 or whatever it is. Because you're doing it in astronomical units. It's 3.3 astronomical units. So if you got to take Earth, which is 103.7 times 149. Or 150. Just do it for 150. 3.7 times 150 and see what you get. Okay? You guys got a number back there? 518.
562 I got from the maximum. Is that what we're supposed to do?
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Versus minimum. That might make a difference.
Oh, I was using the average distance.
Oh, yeah. Well,
Mars.
It's all right. I should have said it's all right. He took the maximum distance, but it's not gonna, huh? Hey, so they did it with astronomic units, and it worked out. They got 562. All right, all right. Just had to convert at the end. 3.7 times or whatever. Okay, you didn't cheat, did you? Did you guys cheat?
No,
did you?
She, oh, okay. Don't know what
she doesn't know what you did, though. Great. Okay. All right. All right.
I came up.
See, Earth is 1. So they multiplied 0.387 times 30.06. Since they got 3 point something or other, which then they stopped. Of course, they got to convert it. They got to multiply it times the Earth, because it's 3.3 astronomical units. So they converted into kilometers.
Oh, that's when they got the correct answer.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah.
That's when
the wrong answer, the correct answer. Right. You guys got, yeah, you got a number, right? 518. I don't know how you got that number.
I used the average distance and got.
Okay, well, let me give you the distance. Now, that number isn't up here anywhere, is it?
No.
500 and whatever. But what's not up here is, as somebody already hypothesizes, the asteroid belt is not up there. The asteroid belt, remember I asked earlier how many people knew where the asteroid belt was when they were a kid or whatever, knew what it was? Well, the asteroid belt is between Mars and Jupiter, and it is from 324.63 million kilometers and 490, is that right? 498.16 million kilometers, is that right? Million kilometers. Yep. Right. Yep, but it's in the ballpark.
562?
Yeah. It's just outside it.
It's way inside it.
462?
462 to 498.
498. 4098. This is the asteroid belt.
The number we're working with, 562, is supposed to be millions of kilometers.
Hmm?
Is that supposed to be millions of kilometers?
How do we get...
It's definitely between Mars and Jupiter.
Yep. You guys, you, which distance did you use? 4537, right?
So we use the maximum distance as we got the 562. So if we do the minimum distance, you would get a...
Maybe I did the minimum, right?
No, I did the average.
Because I got 453, but anyway, it's still outside.
What was that?
The astronaut, but it's still in the ballpark.
What was the figure on the asteroid belt again?
It's basically 324 million kilometers out to about 500 million kilometers. Okay?
500 million?
Yep.
So yours was in the thing, right?
Well, it's all outside of it. It's slightly outside of it. But it's nonetheless, in terms of the distances we're dealing with, it's in the ballpark.
I thought yours was
453.
You said it's outside the
Z
orbit of
Jupiter. You're inside. You're in the right ballpark.
Am I inside? Oh, yeah, I am.
All our numbers are inside Jupiter.
I don't know. I might have 4,537. I didn't realize that before, or I didn't remember this from before, what Jonathan had done. He took the minimum distance from Mercury times the outer distance of Neptune. Okay.
Inner distance.
So you're maximizing the distance you're talking about. From the inner here to the outer here. Those with calculators can whip it out.
459.
Oh, that's what you got. Okay. All right, so then we're in the asteroid belt, right?
Yeah.
Well, see, this is what you have to do. You imagine Jonathan playing with these things, seeing what happens. But that's so we took it from there to there. That was close. We extended it. Yeah. Extended the distance being involved, and we hit the register shift, right? We hit the F sharp, which is, as we keep saying, as Kepler hypothesized, right, this is where a planet should have been. And it turned out years later, right, they found the asteroid belt, an apparently shattered planet. Where's Ahmad? Okay, he's right there. Okay, because I wanted to continue. Okay, so before just to compare the planets, if you can see these things, this is just to compare the planets inside and outside our quote-unquote register shift, right? We'll talk about it more. But that there's a shift. That's what I wanted to just kind of establish for people, all right? Here's different qualities of the planet. I think they're all self-explanatory. This is just how much different than it, more egg-shaped as opposed to circular the planet itself is. And this number of moons over here, surface gravity, right? Now, if just draw an imaginary line, or now we make it so not imaginary line, and compare those above with those below, okay? Look at the shift, for example, in temperatures. These are all minuses, okay? Minus 150. Du-du-du-du-du. These are all aboves, right? Above zero, except for Mars, which goes down to minus 23, or is at minus 23, roughly, give or take.
That's centigrade, right?
Yeah, these would be centigrade, yeah. Yep, see, centigrade. So here, in terms of average temperatures, here's the...
Does that say cloud? Is that what this is?
Yeah.
Cloud. The cloud. They don't know what's underneath it. The number of moons, right? 1, 2, and then it jumps suddenly, 13, 10, 5. Neptune, they're not sure. There may be more for Neptune, and there may be several for Pluto. That's not known.
One, please.
Okay. You take the densities, right? Much greater densities, and then suddenly, right, drops off. Big shift. Volumes, look at these volumes, tiny little volumes. Suddenly, wham, large compared to these, right? All less than one. This is, again, taking Earth as one, right? Same as we're doing with surface gravity here, normalizing to one, okay? Mass, same kind of thing, right? Point, Earth has the most mass of any of the inner planets at one, and then suddenly you're at 317, 95, 14, 17. And so on and so forth, right? And size, just simply look at the size, comparison of sizes, inner and outer. In terms of the actual size of the planet, right? This is probably, what? Well, it's not miles. Oh, the diameter, yeah. It's in miles, yeah. No, miles is like 7,000 miles, so it has to be, yeah, kilometers. Because the diameter of the Earth is about 7,000 plus. In miles. So anyway, just in terms of the, there's a shift at this point of the asteroid belt, at the geometric mean between the inner orbit of Mercury, as we found out, in the outer order orbit of Neptune.
What was it that you said he was saying about Pluto? What was it that you were saying Jonathan was considering about Pluto?
He was hypothesizing, well, he just said it, but I mean, it's a hypothesis, that that Pluto is the beginning of a new set of orbits of planets, that there's more planets beyond Pluto that we don't know yet. One of the qualities of Pluto is that it's very eccentric. You know, the rest are more or less on the plane, the ecliptic.
Well, not only that, but if you look at that listing you were giving us.
Yeah, I was just trying to find it again to put it back up.
Within the orbit of Neptune.
Oh, yeah, in terms of the orbit, yeah. If you look at here, Pluto on its inner orbit, right, goes inside the orbit of Neptune, right? They cross. Yeah. And then look at the shift in eccentricity, right? Inclination of the orbit, how much of an ellipse it is as opposed to a circle. See, some of them are almost, the Earth is almost a circle.
Well, look at Venus is almost a circle.
Venus. Venus and Earth are almost circles, right? But look at here at Pluto. Right. Extremely eccentric orbit, very elliptical orbit.
What does that figure represent? 0.017, what's it mean?
It's a measure of the eccentricity of the orbit. Yeah, it's a derivation, yeah. Okay, so now we're going to. We're going to take our, well, we need a metric. I'm just going to suggest a metric so we're not here all night. I'm going to suggest the metric, which is what I use. Actually, I think it's what Jonathan has suggested. I can't remember. But anyway, the one I use is 2.5 millimeters is equal to, which is just about an inch, but we wanted to be precise as we can. Two and a
centimeters.
Centimeters, I'm sorry. 2.5 centimeters. Excuse me. Which is it to 100 million kilometers. Okay? So, see, these are in millions of kilometers, right?
100 million
km. Right.
We're going to draw the speech. You're going to start doing the orbits, the inner and outer orbits.
Yep. that's what we're going to do. But you got to work them out. No, minimum and maximum.
Okay, Brian, now it's the idea, okay, we've got to do the inner and outer limits of each orbit.
Of each planet.
Each one.
Right. The aphelion and perihelion of each planet.
Okay. These are 100 million.
Right. Okay. Now, if you wanted to use a different scale, you can. I'm just suggesting that. I'm suggesting you do it on that scale and do it between on a single sheet of paper from the sun to the outer edge of the asteroid belt. And if you do that, you can get it on one sheet of paper, which is what I have it on here.
Okay, so we're not starting with Mercury, we're starting with the sun.
Yeah, we'll just make the center the sun. Okay, right. Right. Huh? Both. Right. Like here. The one will give you the inner figure, right? One will give you the outer figure. Okay? One figure will give you the inner, one figure will give you the outer. Right, perihelion, aphelion. Aphelion, aphelion.
And the asteroid belt is
Oh yeah, and the asteroid belt, since it's not up there, the asteroid belt is on the perihelion is 324.63 million kilometers. And on the aphelion, it's 498.16 million kilometers.
What was the other one, 320 what?
324.63, to be exact.
All right, 2.5 tons. So I don't know how you figure that. What did you do? Two circles?
Yeah. Claude, you're not... You can't run the camera and do and run a compass at the same time, huh? Oh no, I remember years ago. I think it was at the. It may have been at the Democratic Convention in '88, in Atlanta. Was that in '88? Can't remember. If it was there or some other time that I. It was one of the first times I ran into you, and you were talking. Was it '84? And you were. Talking about the relationships among various geometric figures. I can't even remember the figures you were talking about, but you were just bubbling over with stuff.
Well,
simple. 0.5 equals 20 million.
Can you have you panned the room a few times, Claude, to take in this beehive of activity?
You should have made
should have made the 100 million a fraction multiple of 10.
Yeah,
what you get a lot more accurate because you got 20 million kilometers in half a centimeter.
Okay.
Yeah, I know. It's
okay.
Well, like I said, you can make it to any scale you want.
Here you go. X equals
that was just my suggestion.
By 45 points. Give me a calculator quick.
What?
I need a calculator. What is it? What
are the numbers you got?
45.9.
Hey, Daddy, show this
calculator.
2 centimeters. Well, we got this figured out. We got to get that on
the
scale.
Okay, so we got the minimum.
Oh, you did a whole bunch of minimums, and then you're going through and doing the maximums, huh?
No, now this is the maximum, right? Of mercury, right, Craig?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go to the maximum.
2.5. Maximum, right? 1.75.
Okay, we really can't go beyond one decimal.
Yeah.
Right. Inaccurately.
No, I'm trying to give you as many divisions as you can.
He's doing it inaccurately.
What?
I'm trying to compare this right here
mm-hmm.
to the number of centimeters I'm supposed to draw this thing.
Right.
What I'm doing is taking 2.5 is to 45.9 is to 100, okay? As 2.5 is to X.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And that's coming out to something like 7 point something or other. Basically, 250 divided by 45.9. I know that's not right. It's not something like 7 centimeters or whatever. Am I doing this right?
So divide. Take 2
minutes right here.
Okay, you want to find.
Is that the right ratio? 45.9 is to 100 as 2.5 is to X. It should be something under 2.5. It should be.
Well.
He's doing it inaccurately.
No, listen up.
No, this should work out. You should end up with about one millimeter here. That's right.
I'm saying, but I'm not ending up with one. I'm ending up with
well, what are you doing that for? Oh, wait, what's going on? What are you doing here wrong?
This equation, 45.9 times X.
You
got to
keep it within the page.
But that X is 1. Why do you make it X? X is 1 there. You know it's 1.
Do you know it's 1? You want to find out what it is.
Oh.
That's why I made it X. I want to find out what it is.
No, this is the relationship to right.
Kilometers.
Well,
millions of kilometers.
Right. And this is to
centimeters.
Here. This is how many this is 100 million kilometers,
I think I did it
right?
Wrong. I think it was supposed to be 2.5 to 100.
This
is 45.9
is
to X. That's what I was
supposed to do. Yeah, because if you just...
Right?
You can if
you take 45.9 over 100 times 2.5, you get the figure. Because 45.9 over 100 is the relationship between your metric, which is 100 million kilometers, and 45 million kilometers. In other words, it's about one half times 2.5. Okay? Mm-hmm. So if you see that two and a half times 45 gives you a little over 100, right? Mm-hmm. And divide by 100, and it'll give you 1 point something or other, and that's correct. So okay, just do that.
Make 100 million kilometers equal 2 centimeters. They give you 20 divisions, 20 millimeters.
Well, what I'm saying is
each one equals 5 million miles.
0.5x is equal to
5. You can easily multiply 5 out of 100.
Okay, well, then just do it. I mean, do it with her or work with her on it. Did you?
Wait a minute. 4590. Right, 100 times this is 459.
What are we supposed to be trying?
Yeah, two zeros. Zero, zero. Is that right?
No, 1-0.
1-0?
Mm-hmm. But I don't know why you're doing that.
I don't either.
just.
It's got to be some kind of relationship. You're trying to figure out what this is to.
Five.
The centimeters.
This is 5 seconds, 2.5. This is 2.5, right? 2.5 millimeters, right, is equal to 100
million.
Centimeters, right.
Make it 20 millimeters
times 45.9 over 100. Okay? So you multiply this times this, which is 91.8, right? Or let's see. Oh, this is multiplied. 45.4, 29.2, divided by 200 is equal to 1.1. 0.95 or 4.
Now, what are we supposed
see,
to
this is 200, 29.5. Still 195. Bring over 0. So that's 450, 0, and then 9 or something like that. Multiply this times this, right? Multiply this times this.
This is.
There's centimeters. I'm sorry. This is centimeters.
Okay, but this is centimeters.
2.5 centimeters is equal to 100 meters. You've got 45. So you're putting 49.5 over 100 to compare the two. Okay? So you got a fraction. Okay? And you're multiplying it that times 2.
Well, this thing I don't understand is multiplication. I understand is ratios.
Right. So you're trying to find this is the ratio of the of the
let me just work this out.
Okay.
Should be drawing a damn
just round them up to
model
2.
Of the solar system.
6 or 7, whatever. Well, which one okay. I just 2.7.
It's supposed to come out to be a mile of the solar system, right?
2.7.
Huh?
Dan is asking if you sure they have a model of the solar system.
Sure, got the same
thing. Yeah.
You heard the KISS principle, Brian?
The what?
KISS, keep it simple.
Well, things can always be perfected.
All right. Mercury, Venus, put that back up. What's the orbit of Venus? What's the orbit of Venus? How can Venus get the
John, why didn't you do anything?
Okay, I'm just.
There's no one to do either. I don't know.
No.
It's a simple ratio. It's a man, I can't even get anyone.
Dan?
Okay.
Dan, why don't you instead help John? Dan?
Yeah, I heard.
Make John do it.
Okay.
What are we supposed to be doing? Just drawing a map of the thing with the minimum and maximum distance?
Right, for right now. Then we'll take the next step. First, we got to get that down.
Keep it simple. Forget the damn
half. I'm handing
in
my homework.
You're injuring us.
You're injuring us.
Okay, I can do it too.
He didn't commit suicide. No, he didn't get put in a mental asylum. No, he didn't.
Okay, next is 20 every millimeter.
Okay.
2 centimeters equals 100 miles. Mm-hmm. Therefore, equal to every millimeter, 20 miles is 5.
I don't think you can.
That's close enough.
Centimeters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's close enough. Do that next.
So, if 2 centimeters, right? One millimeter, 20.
Huh?
We're going to play the universe on
the. Well, that's the idea.
Holtz, you're not going to play Holtz's planets, I don't
know. No, no. Guys, you're keeping up with these guys. Yeah.
Once we figured out the 2.5 centimeters, how did you figure that one? That was the biggest problem. This stuff is just simple.
You want the meet the maximum minimum, right?
Yeah. Huh?
Well, I got something for this, but this is 79.
Put 65, right? 65.9 over 100, and multiply by 5 seconds, 5 halves, 2.5. 100 million. Let me explain. 100 million kilometers, right, is equal to 2.5 centimeters, right? Okay.
Got that ratio down.
So you want to find out what the relationship of your planet is that you're talking about to the 2.5 centimeters. How many times it is it? Okay. So in this case, you want to put 69.7 over 100.
Right. Just roughly 70 over 100.
Right. Just do it and multiply it by 5 seconds or 2.5.
Seconds. Seconds? Is that what you're saying?
5/2.
What is it?
5 halves.
That's the average distance.
Or times 2.5, however you want to do it. So you get 350 in the top, right? 70 times 5 is equal to 350.
Uh-huh.
And you multiply 2 times 100 in the bottom, and you get 200. Okay, so now divide 200 into 350.
The top and the bottom part. I'm not sure what you're doing
that, but anyway.
Well, that's how you do with multiplication. You multiply the tops and bottoms times each other.
I know, but I don't understand why you have, you're multiplying the relationship
because
between
you,
this and this multiplied by this.
If you had 1 gallon of gas.
If you had 3 gallons of gas and you had out of 10, you want to find out.
And you had
10 gallons of gas goes 1 mile, you want to find out how many gallons of gas, how many miles 3 gallons will go. What I would do, if you had 10 gallons of gas and it goes 1 mile, how many miles 3 gallons of gas would go. This is what I would do. I would make an equal sign there and try to find out what X is. That's the way they taught it in school. 10X equals 3. X equals 10 into 3. Right? You divide by 10 and divide by 10, 3/10. So the answer here is 3/10.
But you already know that. You already knew 3/10.
How would you know that?
You already wrote it down here. I think you're confused, I think, in terms of your example you're using.
Maybe, suppose it was 4 and 8. Mm-hmm. 8 gallons went 1 mile. How many gallons would 4? How many miles would 4 gallons
okay.
go?
There are, can you understand?
8x equals 4 divided by 8. Divided
well, you can do it however you'd like. I'm suggesting a way. If you take 200 and 350 now, you will get the number. You got 1 point whatever before, and now you're going to get the number this time. 1.75 or something, right? Okay, so that's your second number.
I just don't understand why you do this. Multiply by 502.
Because that's 2.5 centimeters.
Yeah.
It's 2.5 centimeters is your metric. It's
right.
Like taking astronomical units. This time we're taking 2.5 centimeters as our astronomical unit. And we're taking a planet which is only 6/10 of such a figure, right? Or 7/10 of such a figure, right? So it's 7/10 of one astronomical unit. But as opposed to being one, it's 2.5 centimeters.
Okay.
So we want to find out what percentage of 2.5 centimeters it is. You follow me?
It might be coming in clear.
Yeah, no, it takes a while. I worked this stuff through a couple years ago when I was going back looking at my notes again. It was like all Greek to me. I had to learn it all again. Marcia, are you?
Hi.
Are you?
I'm observing. Yes. I'm an OBE observer. Yes.
Yeah. You're doing clinical work.
Yeah. Yeah. I came in too late to have to do the hard work.
Oh, I see. Oh, I see. I didn't.
Mars, that 206 or 208
points. Good question. Let's see. I've got it written down here.
And then
you know where the sun is.
206.
You know, certain planets like Mercury just kind of go up the horizon,
and then they'll go back down.
A planet like Mercury or Venus will never get directly above. That's the kind of thing.
Well, figure out the sun's down there.
You got it up to Jupiter. How, boy, what scale did you guys use?
We just did one side.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the very end.
Well, it's going to create problems in terms of what we're going to do next, but you can just tape some more pieces together around it. And
all we can do, we can just Xerox this and flip it over. How about that?
Yeah, yeah, hey, there.
Bring this one.
Huh?
Models show us that way. Okay, so you can normally. Well, I don't know about that. You know, here you are.
This is Mercury.
And
let's
say
this
is
the one
that has
to be on it. You'll see it just on the horizon.
Over to here, yes, angle the sun and
okay, can we proceed? Yeah, but if it always maximum, you're doing a circle.
Bellissimo. How's it going, Harley? How's it going?
I'm trying to see if these guys can find Jupiter.
If you want to start on the next one, you can, but I think it's getting kind of late, so.
Okay, so then what do we do?
Okay, now, the next project. Okay, next part of this, okay? Now, what we want to do is we're going to examine the musicality of the solar system, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to divide this circle we've got into 12 parts, 12 equal parts, 12 notes in the scale, 12 days, 12 hours in the day, 12 hours in the night, 12 months in the year. 12 is a multiple of 3 times 4, 2 of the faces. 3 times 4 times 5 is 60, which is 60 minutes, 60 hours, so on and so forth. Right? So anyway, so we're going to divide it into, happy 60th birthday. No. So we're going to divide this circle into 12 parts, okay? And we're going to see what happens when we map each of these planets. And it's a series, right? Divide it in half, then divide it in half again, and then in two more, and then each quarter into two parts. 12 parts.
Are you talking about this thing that we just drew?
Yep.
We got to trisect the angle in order to
fold your circle over. Cut it out and fold it over. Well, if you can see it through it, or if you have a perfectly square piece of paper. If you know where the center is, any straight line through the center is going to give you a diameter. Any arbitrary straight line, as long as it goes through the center, will give you a diameter. All right, you're getting some circles. All right. You're getting into the sink. Have you? Okay. Venus, you only have to do one for Venus. And it's almost one. It's just a little over one. So if you just.
It's a. Same? Oh, yeah, it's close. It's
107, right? Yeah.
How come this looks so different than mine?
Because it's on a different scale. He's using a different scale.
What's the easiest way to divide this?
Well, you have 2 points.
We can do half and half again. I'd use that. That's right. It's a 90, so you need 30 and 60.
45. You have 45 right there.
Yeah, but to forget the 45, just do 30 and 60. If you do it, you know, if you line it up, so 0 and 90 is on, right? Then you get 60 and 30 are the divided, right?
Once you get folded in half, and how do you get?
Well, you can do it half and then half again.
We did that. We got half and
half. But then do half and half again.
Right.
Because if you do half.
No,
it doesn't work.
It doesn't work. You get, we have to get a 1-2 triangle, and that what we have to do to get a 30-30.
Yeah, you get 30-30-30, half of 45.
Yeah, I guess so.
That's like having a 1-2 triangle.
It's got to be, wait, hold on.
It's got to be 6. You're dividing this in 6.
Yeah, here.
Just fold it in thirds. Simple enough.
Fold it in thirds.
The trisection of an angle is not.
Oh, yeah, it's all 90 degrees into thirds. Huh?
Take another piece of paper and fold it in thirds.
I mean,
this is almost.
Draw.
Well, you can take a, any circle, the what, the diameter is equal to the 1/6 the circumference, or a pentagram. No, not pentagram, but a, what, a six-sided? A six-sided figure will...
How do you do that? We got this and this. Now, how do you get this?
I think, yeah, you... You can go... Well, let's see. There's a couple... I mean, what is it?
I don't know.
I'm trying to remember. Must be the radius, huh? The radius of a circle gives you a six-sided figure. The radius. Yeah. So if you have a six-sided figure, then you can have the each of the
perfect.
Right?
Oh, that's perfect. Here.
Does that help?
Oh, the radius.
Yeah.
That's it. Never guessed that. Man, that was from his first class.
Oh, yeah, she's in Bonnie's place. Do you have a phone list from the National Center?
No, I don't. Yeah.
I've got it in my... Yeah.
Where are you going?
Sure. You fudge by using that.
I could do it if I wanted to work hard, you know.
The easiest solution is that of a circle, the radius of a circle is always will make a six-sided figure. If you take the radius and you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that'll create 6. So then if you have each of those, right, you'll get 12. Right?
But wait a minute, where do you put it?
Yeah, the radius, like that.
Where do you put it? Over here?
Well, that's what you'd find out.
You really want me to tell you where to stick it?
What you'd find out doing what you're doing, what you've already done.
You take that with the compass, and then what do you do with it?
If you take this, from here to here, right? Then that's the same as from here to here. Mm-hmm. And you walk it around, you know. Then that defines the next one, and then that defines the next one. And that. So then you get six-sided, and then you just have each of those, and then you'd have a 12-sided figure, right? Yeah. So that's the way of doing it without the knowing the degrees.
How do you have it? Suppose you have 6 points, how do you get a half
of
those 2 points?
You just fold it.
Oh, you just fold it?
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, or, you know, if you have a compass, you know how to do it with a compass?
No.
Do you remember? I know you knew, yeah.
I used to know
all the edges.
Right. You take here and you go out here.
Oh, yeah, right.
And you take here, right there,
right? That's right.
Right, and then you do the same on the inside and draw the line?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay, now what are we supposed to do?
The old cobwebs are...
draw the line then, right?
Right.
Draw the lines, yeah.
Just draw the lines through there, right?
Yeah.
Just draw them through. Vroom, vroom, vroom. Okay. All right. Well.
After we divided it up over here, Joel started talking about pizza.
Joel falls into the goo face first. Okay, so we'll go ahead and move along, right? Everyone's all right. Well, let's see. How do you think? You know, you could try any number of ways, right? To see what would work here. But maybe I should leave this up. I mean, for starters, right? It seems that some of the planets, like here, Venus, I mean, that really looks, if that's a note, that's one note. It ain't two notes, right? So you can take the average or whatever, you know. So that's, but that would only be one of them. Mercury, however, well, that's, all right. And the Earth, that's probably one, right? Yeah. And we're not going too much further. And the asteroid belt, well, that's pretty big.
Wide,
big too.
What are you trying to figure out now?
Well, how are you going to map these? I mean, I don't want to just say, well, this is how you do it, and then just do it. I mean, there's, you know, the point is, should be a certain kind of reasonableness to it.
Sun to Mercury establishes an interval. That is your first interval from the Sun.
Right. And so now we're interested in the interval, really, from Mercury to the asteroid belt, in what we've drawn here. We're interested in half of the spiral, half of one complete spiral from Mercury, following along with what Jonathan did, half of a spiral, halfway around a complete spiral, right? Because we're only going out to the asteroid belt, out to the geometric mean or thereabouts, right? So what I'm saying, okay, so map, so start at one point, wherever you want to start, and map Mercury there. Put Mercury at its perihelion, at the first. Right, go out the distance to Mercury and mark it. Okay. Now move around to the next note. We're going to go to the next note, and we're going to make that the epihelion of Mercury, the next note, going outward. So now you're at the perihelion, right? You drew an inner and outer circle, right, for Mercury. But where you're going to mark it is on the second line you drew. So you're rotating as you go. So you're going from 45.9 to 69.7 million kilometers, right? You're moving. So then from there, you're moving to the third line, the third note. You're going around the conophone, if you've played with conophones, right? Going around the third string for Venus. And you're marking Venus at the third string, right? Well, they're so close. It's so close. When you drew them, you could hardly.
You think Mars is going to be two notes?
Well, that's Mars. Doesn't look like to me like a note or two notes.
You got to take the difference there.
Maybe. Well, no. I would the way Jonathan does it, since he's the one we're going here. He does the epihelion as one note, and then he marks out the perihelion as a quarter note vibrato, as a quarter of a note vibrato, right? A vibrato, right? Well, he was jumping ahead to Mars. Earth is the next note. Venus, then the next note is Earth, which is one note, right? Because it's only 147 to 152, very close, right? So you're going to be talking about a note or a vibrato around a note, right? Right? Okay. Think of Venus that way, and so it's different amounts of vibrato around a note. Okay? Since that's how you sing bel canto, right? That's not a... And then Mars... Okay, Mars, you're approaching, think of it this way maybe, as you approach the register shift, your voice, there's more energy, right? You're using more energy, you're getting less out as you approach that barrier, right, until you make the breakthrough, right? So at that point, you've got a quarter note vibrato, right? Maybe. Okay. And then you've got the asteroid belt.
Yeah, what about the next note after the inner one of Mars? It's the same thing. It's still a vibrato. It's not the...
It's a vibrato. It's
go around the next piece of the pi there. We're not going to go to this line.
We're only going half of a spiral here. Mars is only, it's all around one note. But the note that Jonathan maps is the perihelion, which he maps on the string, right? On what is your fifth string, right? And then he maps a quarter note further out, so it's in between the two strings, as where the epihelion falls. And that quarter note is the vibrato with which it moves, right, from the epihelion to the perihelion, right?
So he's saying the outer.
So it's moving on out, right? You're marking it further out in distance away from the center on the outer edge of the of those two circles that you drew for Mars, right? About a quarter of the distance between the Mars string and the next string, which will be the asteroid, the inner
asteroid?
Yes, the perihelion of the asteroid belt. And then the sixth string is the epihelion of the asteroid belt, right? Okay. Now, after you've mapped those points, look at these points. Do you see a pattern to those?
Yeah, except the Mars thing doesn't fit.
Yeah, it does. Yes, it does.
You don't have two. You don't have two notes with Mars. You have one.
One, and then a little clip off. The rest of the seat, Joe. Just make about a third. That's how this quarter notes are.
I never got that far. It's supposed to be a spiral.
I mean, the point about the quarter note is that it's not a.
Yeah, I guess it would be more of an eighth of a tone. But. Inner planets, yeah, that's inner planets.
It's actually,
so you get a spiral? Is this all boring you guys to death? You already got it, huh? You already got it. It's already old news, huh? Old hat. Okay. All right. Now this is, now we can go ahead and map the, we can map the other planets, but it's getting late, okay? This is the scale that you did it, this inner part. But this is how much paper you've got to do to have it to go out to Uranus. This is the same scale as you guys used to do this part, okay? But to get out to Uranus, you got to have that much paper, which tells you a sense of the universe, huh? How large it is. But this is what you get if you continue to map it out. Right through Uranus, Saturn, Jupiter. The only one that doesn't fit at all is Jupiter. The G note on Jupiter falls, falls. If it's going to fall on the spiral, it's going to fall halfway between the string G and the string A flat. In other words, what falls on the string is not a note. Okay. But Jonathan wouldn't disagree with that. I mean, he maps it this way, okay? His point, he's not saying, I've got the perfect system. Ted came up with a better system, Ted Andromedas, which is even more perfect. He comes up with a slightly different geometric way. I don't remember. But the point is that Jonathan's is actually the most interesting one in the sense that he's the one that came up with the conception of how you would approach it, and then Ted took that idea and then developed it further, which is fine. It's good, right? So Jonathan wasn't saying his was the cat's meow. This is how the universe works. This was the way God, created the orbits of the planets. But you can see on a large scale a comparison to what Kepler did, you know, with the five planets. Here you can see on the large scale what, and using the conic function, right, a spiral on a cone, more accurate mapping of the orbits of the planets. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, that's the next step. I can just if let me just leave it with this, so and people can play with this. If you now equal temper these figures, each of these figures, I mean these you can treat as one. Okay. But at equal temper, if you know equal tempering, it's the 12th root of 2, 12th root of 2 for each note. If you find, which is 1.466, I think. If you multiply 1.466, you can figure, we'll talk about equal tempering next week. But if you multiply 1, let me get the right figure, I think it's 1.466, which is the 12th root of 2. Yeah, 1.466 times every one of these orbits, you'll find that you get very close to the notes of the scale, with one or two exceptions.
So you actually get what would be the equivalent of frequencies.
You're right.
The pitches except much higher.
Right.
The numbers are much higher than it would be, but if you
between, well, I'm sorry. If you between the planets, if you take between the planets, if you divide 69.7 into 45.9, you're going to get 1.466. Okay? If you divide Venus at, well, these are slightly jerry-rigged figures I have here. But if you divide Venus into Earth, you're going to get, in terms of this figure, you're going to get about 1.466.
Yeah, that's good.
And so on and so forth. You're going to get you're going to get an equal temper. You're going to find an equal tempering between the in the intervals between the planets.
So there's an equal relationship between each.
Right, right. Which is not the same thing as well tempering, right?
But
each note is exactly the 12th root of 2 apart. It's the same, absolutely same difference between each note.
Which one
but
the planets themselves correspond to, say, C is 256, and if you multiply it times.
Oh.
And you're going to get a figure that's way
up. But it does. But it does correspond. It does correspond. But I don't remember what the figure is. I'll find that for next week. Yeah, you go down to the you can go down to the biological level.
So Kepler used
the
well temper system.
He did the natural tuning. So, in terms of the, I've got a set of figures here. Let's see. I think somewhere, which I did a few years back. Well, I think I'll just leave it at that. But if you want to, you can. I would just take some of these figures. I would divide them and see what you get as terms of the ratios of the larger to the smaller figures. And I have a set of them here too, which people can compare against once they do it.
You see all the places where we made notes along the way. That's what we're going to find. You're saying that all the places that we made between the aphelion and the aphelion, that's what we're going to find.
Is the ratios.
The ratio of 1.4.
Right. If you take Mercury is at 67.3, I don't know how these figures are. These are the figures that he used as that you derived. So these figures differ a little. But for example, 67.3 times 1.466 gives you 98.7, which is Venus, basically the middle, close to the orbit of Venus. Venus at 98.7 times 1466 gives you 144.7, which is just about the Earth. Earth, 144.7 times 1.466 gives you 212.13, which is in the middle of orbit of Mars. Mars at 212.13 times 1.466 gives you 309.98, which is just short of the beginning of the asteroid belt, right? If you take the asteroid, if you then let's see what happens there. I guess yeah, and then the next one gives you about 456, which is the asteroid belt. Then the next time, 456 times 1.466 gives you 669. This is this one where it gets the note is totally off. It's there, you know. It's not. But then if you take the same number for Jupiter, 669, and you multiply it times 1.466, you get 1,435, which is right in the middle of Saturn. And then it picks up Uranus and Neptune a lot, right along the same line. So each one of them is exactly the 12th root of 2.
But when you do this so-called natural tuning,
it's equal tuning. Equal tuning. It's called equal because the distances between each note is exactly equal.
The vibrations of the string go up 1.466 every half step or every.
Yeah, I guess.
Half step.
Right, every half step. Right. That's right. Yep. Yeah, well, according to this set of, it's not off. Our approach is somewhat off.
You know, it's the Jupiter is oddest of all.
The first odd one.
Yeah, that's true,
no,
right.
It's the oddest. Well,
with
the
most,
in other words, it's not
well,
just that it
the asteroid
begins, it's
belt
total
is the
different.
Oddest. That's the one that first.
Yeah,
no, but
what I'm saying is it's in that second set of planets, mm-hmm. It has the most, you know, enormous. If you look at it, it has the most enormous mass. You look at the figures.
Yeah, sure. I'm trying to find that. I know what you're trying to say.
Anomalous.
Yeah, that's the word.
Another strange thing about Jupiter is it's actually putting out energy.
See, look at the mass. The mass is massive.
No other planet's doing
it. The volume is massive.
All other planets are putting out energy.
Compared to all the rest of them, it's really the most anomalous.
It puts out energy and absorbs.
Okay. So we'll come back to Sylvia's article next week. I wanted to do this first. I thought it would.
No, I'll go back and reread it now that I.
We'll work through. We'll take like the cube and the dodecahedron and actually work through how you come up with the diameters or the radiuses. If you.
<That's good. laughs>